That'd be busy. Turn me a little more gray.
And here's the fund balance. We have $21 million at the end of fiscal year 2019 in capital projects. Unassigned is about $9.9 million. So the general fund is $16.5 million. So we're under our 8% limit, sorry, not in such a thing. We're under our limit. This unassigned number is limited to 8% by state, so we can't go over 8% of our budget.
So we have $21.5 million in our capital projects.
That was at June 30th of 2019, so.
So this, there's an additional $5 million on top of that?
No, the $5 million's in there, but the projects we did over last summer are coming. Come out of that, so. We spent last year, Sheriff, kind of like about $3.5 million.
Not right here.
Over last summer, so. So we did it down. This is just a slide on Peaser's rates, what the rates have done and the increased cost to our budget, net cost to our budget each year. So, and then where's it gonna go? We are now up to $22.5 million in Peaser's expense. And by 2027, 2028, that'll be up to just under $25 million. And that's if we don't have about a dollar more in salaries. So Peaser's just continue to go up. It's just that these huge chunks aren't as big each year. This is 38.17. When business managers get together and have fun, yes, we're that's gonna end.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Like tricky cake based on.
And that's the Peaser's rate chart as it has, I think it's one of those. So here's where we're at. Outstanding considerations. Property general liability insurance is estimated in the budget. Our agents come in and early spring and give us a pretty good estimate. They're generally a little bit higher than where they need to be. They'll come back in June and give us final numbers. It won't be really appreciable, but we just need to make sure that we have enough money in the budget. We always do so far since I've been here. They give us good rates. It's a budget. Stop loss, that quote will come in later in May or June. Again, money's in there. School bus funding, thank you for the year 16-17 on. You've given us $850,000 a year to buy school buses, and that's why those charts are starting to look so good with our age of our buses. The mileage, when I got here, we had not bought buses for quite some time. We were running 20-year-old buses with 300,000 miles on it. Man, they were just bad.
So one of the things that we talked about was the cost of maintaining those buses.
So
exceeded the cost to replace them and have four buses. So that really guided us in the direction.
Any what budgetary reserve do we have in the budget? And request for new positions, which will continue to go through the next couple of months with you for the next couple of meetings. Governor's budget is included. I don't foresee anything more than that coming out of the state. Utilizing fund balance, the budget cannot be balanced, or funding that special project or something that might come up. And anything that might have to do with the state budget or any other potential legislation or anything for security grants or anything like that may come out of the state. So those are things that are still out there on the table, but these things really don't have a lot of, won't have a lot of impact on where we're at. So. Questions?
Good work.
Good. Like the numbers.
Yeah.
Poor guy.
So as David mentioned earlier, and Sean was mentioning, so a couple of the newer positions that we are looking to focus on as we go into next year, and a lot of discussion ever since I came into the district just among the principals and saying about the kindergarten program, and there are some identified students that would really benefit from a full-day program, because I think all of you know, I helped lead a full-day into a full-day program in my previous district. And I'm not saying that's what's needed here. I'm saying that there are identified students that could really benefit from some of that repetition of strategies of learning. So I want to talk a little bit about what we just designed here. And again, this is kind of a first shot at it. So any feedback is definitely welcome. But I've been working with Sarah Baker over at Sellersville, Joe Caleza at Grass, and Casey Ford at Daimler. Sarah and Joan, because that's the two schools we're focusing on for this pilot program. Casey, because she's been working hand-in-hand with the new kindergarten assessment and what that would look like as we identify students to be part of this. So why is the district piloting, why would we want to pilot a targeted full-day program? Because, as I said, there are needs within the district. We do have students who are coming in that are a little bit behind the eight ball in regards to where they should be, whether it be because of the lack of exposure to preschool, just developmentally, it would offer them some opportunities and repetition of learning strategies, and both having that structured and non-structured play, which we hear about all the time, is the lack of play, especially in kindergarten. So the full-day program, how would it be different than what we already have? Because as you know, we do have some kindergarten students who are attending full-day through our artistic support class or emotional support class, and through our developmental kindergarten classes. So this is really proposed that those students who wouldn't have that opportunity, who don't have a specialized program, but are still lacking in the academic and maybe the developmentally appropriate for a kindergarten program. So this would give them that opportunity to jumpstart to get to where their peers are.
And I hope that as you're listening to the presentation, thinking about that this is one of the pieces connecting to the literacy goal. In terms of students who will benefit from additional supports and additional time in kindergarten, the research is pretty clear that there are some students that gap before third grade is benefiting from full day. It is not every student that academically benefits from full day by the end of third grade, but there are some students. So the hope is that as we pilot this and we start looking at who are the right students, that we can help bridge that gap for this set of. This is really part of that presentation.
Absolutely.
Why disposition versus scholars.
And as we're looking at whether or not the child will benefit from a full day, you know, we want to utilize developmentally appropriate research-based assessment. So we're looking at different assessments right now, as David just mentioned, the literacy and the math. We're not looking to add to a program. We're not making this, and I'll say this again later, but we're not making this the new first grade. We don't want to add social studies and science and make it that we want kids to develop those strategies and those skills to be successful as they head into first grade and be with their peers. So the assessment would be administered in later part of June. That's what we're looking at right now. So we'd only be looking at assessing the students in June from Grass and Sellersville, because what we would need is a baseline to see how many students are actually in need of additional support based on the assessment. So the one of the assessments is called the PELI. It's an early literacy assessment. So we can tell from that which of the students are really struggling still to develop their sounds or their letter identification. So we can get a better idea, okay, these are the students that we maybe put our focus on as we determine who's going to benefit from a full-day program. And then parents will be notified their child's eligibility to participate in the program by the beginning of August. We want to make sure they have plenty of time to make a decision whether or not they want to actually have their child be part of a program that would be full day. The program would take place at Sellersville Elementary School. There is room there. And it would be offered to, as I said, students in Grass and Sellersville. We would combine the two schools to have a class of students. We're talking about no more than 15 students in a class, really. So we're really identifying a very specific group of students over the population of two different schools. And then those that would be accepting the invitation would be bused to and from Sellersville Elementary based on the bell schedule from Sellersville. So we do have some runs that are already taking place through the grass attendance zone because we have some developmental kindergarten students who are coming to Sellersville, so we would just have to expand that route. So Jess and I are going to look at that as we move forward to see what would be the max, what would be the minimum of having to develop some routes that would go through the grass attendance area.
And obviously, because this would be potentially moving the public school for some students, right? This would be a parent choice program.
Right.
So we would explain that.
Yep.
So if any for Sellersville parent, if for
Correct.
Students, they would choose not to, we would explain the assessment to them. We would explain why we're offering what we see as the benefits are. But it would ultimately be the parent choice as to whether they want the child to participate or not.
And then, so what is the day going to look like? It's a full day program with students' opportunity to expand on reading, mathematics, and social emotional learning. Like I said, we don't want to add anything to it of social studies or science. So again, it's not the new first grade. We're not looking to take these students and sell them beyond the kindergarten curriculum. And we're not even looking to extend upon our adopted programs that we use, such as the kindergarten making, reading, being a writer, and the everyday math. We want them to utilize those programs to really develop the foundational skills that would benefit them as learners. And then what would it look like for a full day? Offer students the opportunity to expand again. What the program is, it offers remediation and repetition of the math and reading strategies, interactive engagement, both structured and non-structured play, and preparing students for becoming academically, socially, emotionally successful that will develop them further as a student as they go through their schooling. There's actually programs out there for structured and non-structured play that would benefit. I'm not saying we adopt something like that, but we, as we work with the kindergarten teachers, we want to make sure that they understand that there are programs available to them so they don't feel like they're designing something brand new, but they would benefit from programs that are available to them. So what the program would look like for the district, possibly one full-time teacher and one definitely a full-time aide. I say possibly because I'm not sure whether if we get those students that would combine, would it reduce the section and part of Sellersville and grass, that we could have that teacher, but we're not saying that for sure because we want to see what it would look like based on our enrollment number as well.
So we budgeted for the positions.
Correct.
Because
and
the problem
both aid and teacher.
But there are certain numbers that would be pretty numbers that if you removed a lot of students, if you removed nine students in Sellersville, we're actually seeing the teacher in Sellersville section. So it might be a lot.
Right.
But
to go in this program? I'm thinking about 15. It's a little bit below the norm of a full class of about 20 students. We really want to keep it down a little bit because we want those opportunities for small group learning. And once you get to that point, especially students who have specific needs, we want to make sure we're giving that attention to be able to be successful.
So what happens?
I think
you're
like
the
So right now we'll be on a ranking order. Look at those 15 didn't invite, but it still wouldn't exclude. I was talking about to Sarah about this Baker actually today, is they have that power hour, that extended piece that they would still continue to encourage to parents to take advantage of. So students are getting that little bit extra support even if they didn't make the top 15 and made the cut to be part of the full day program.
That they would schedule what?
There's power hour at some of the schools where they extend the kindergarten hour, so they have that overlap of kindergarten between the AM and PM, and where students are transitioning, some are getting some a little bit of extra support by staying and getting that additional support from the teachers, the kindergarten teachers. So the program supplies, we would need program supplies for the teacher if it was an additional section of kindergarten. But in regards to the student materials, the materials are already accounted for in the budget, so there would be no additional cost there. And again, the transportation would just be based on the additional routes that would be needed. We would determine whether or not, you know, there would be an increase. If it were, I really truly believe it would be minimal because of running routes through that area, right, for our developmental kindergarten class. So the programs will be found eligible through a research-based assessment. Like I had mentioned, Casey Plourd has been wonderful in just seeking out the different assessments that are available for early literacy skills and early math skills, and looking at the different programs and what would be most beneficial to us. I had the opportunity to go up to visit Quakertown during their kindergarten registration process as well, and see them utilizing their tool that they use, and it's a quick 10-minute tool that they go through just to understand where the student is as a learner. And then it will be administered, as I said, to the incoming kindergartners for Grass and Sellersville, and then again to be identified at the beginning of August for those students to have an invitation. And then the will be expanded. Again, it would be the success of the program. So we would evaluate, we're going to develop metrics, and we've really talked about the importance of having metrics in place to determine whether or not there was success in utilizing a full-day program. And then, if so, we would look to possibly expand it to additional schools for the 21-22 school year.
I was looking at it from a metric standpoint. You take it out the next year? The year up to the next year to find out if it's actually.
Well, you're going to look at the growth of the students. Absolutely. Perfect. So you're going to be looking at the various assessments that we use internally, ready, the Fox and Pinnell reading, the math inventory. There is actually Pennsylvania has a kindergarten readiness inventory, as well as if they do a pre and a post of using that. So just to help us understand, was it beneficial for sure?
Because I was thinking, take it out the next year. Your kindergarten, what is it like at the end of first grade?
That's going to tell you
whether your program is successful or not.
And then definitely by that end of the third grade that Dr. Golden was talking about, is, you know, our goal is to have every third grader on reading level.
But in terms of deciding whether or not to expand it, you have to do something.
Exactly that first year. And obviously surveys for the parents, forms with the parents, because we do want that other information to really tell us, you know, was it beneficial for your child, was it beneficial for you, because... So a lot of the studies do say by third grade, everyone kind of balances out to some degree. And a lot of that, if you read it, has to do with the social-emotional aspect.
Oh, okay.
So because of that development in the early childhood ages.
And this is something we're focusing on then, too. Okay.
Right.
So the program could be so successful, mm-hmm. and you really push a full-day kindergarten at the very end. After 3 years, it's so successful, you're going to have a flow of people saying, well, my son and daughter are full-time.
You could, but again, the reasoning would be
not
that it's not
it's
for everybody,
scenario, but
it's not necessary for everybody.
Right, but like they're saying, it's not every student needs the benefits
it's a
from
the demographic that you're looking to.
So, but you could.
Mm-hmm.
So,
questions?
My only thought, you know, when we're looking at these kinds of programs, and we do some of this, but we don't do it to this extent, right? We already have a full-day program for kids who qualify for some reasons, but we're expanding the pool of students who qualify.
Mm-hmm.
And my concern with this is I would like to see it be more of an inclusive option. Why can't we just expand what we already have and put all of those kids together and have these kids stay in their home schools? I'm not a big fan of moving kids to other schools than their home schools. And if you're talking about social and emotional learning being a big focus, having a kid go to one school for kindergarten and then moving them to a different school for first grade is going to have an impact on the social and emotional learning. And so I have, my son is in kindergarten right now. He's in the half-day program in the morning. And then he stays after and goes to special education for additional supports, for additional special education to reinforce things, for accommodations for him, for things that he needs. it's working really well for him, and he's in his home school. And he's getting those educational needs through that program and getting the additional benefits that he's getting the accommodations afterwards in the special education group. Mm-hmm. If what we're saying is that these additional kids would benefit from specific areas, because we're targeting needs. We're looking at students who qualify for one reason or another and they have specific needs. I feel like that model makes a lot of sense and it's working really well, and I would like to see us expand that. So those kids are then staying after and getting those additional supports. And when you look at that second half of the day, there's not a lot of time. And so that was one of the things we're looking at with him and getting him those additional supports, because you've got to fit in, you've got lunch, you've got recess, you've got special. By the time you take into account all of those things, the amount of time left for the educational reinforcement piece that you're talking about is very small. And that can be met in that inclusive setting for all of those kids. And when you think about the fact that there's probably about 40 kids in the district who maybe would qualify based on the numbers that we're looking at, if you spread that out between 7 different schools, you're talking about only a few students per school. I mean, obviously it's not going to work out that pretty, right? But absorbing those kids so that those kids get the same, or in with all of their peers for the morning program or the afternoon program, depending on how you do it, but it seems to make the most sense for that stronger academic piece to be in the morning for those struggling students. If those kids are then pushed in with the other kids who need those additional accommodations for the second half of the day in each building, now you're really targeting the needs of those individual students, and you're doing it all together in an inclusive setting. And you're really, in a lot of cases, utilizing the resources that we already have by combining them with those other kids instead of targeting specific buildings, there's a problem with that.
How is this different?
The problem with that is that then you don't have one class without a structure throughout the entire day. So, in other words, the ESL population in my son's school come to regular ed kindergarten for half the day, and then we're in with the ESL teacher the other half of the day. They are pulled from all over the district to fill one class. If you've only got a handful of kids, 5 kids in every building, if you don't pull them all together in one class, you've now got 5 kids the other half of the day. You don't necessarily want to send them to kindergarten twice, you know? So the way that you're saying, if they stay in their own building, they would be doing this regular kindergarten program for AM, let's say, staying for lunch and recess, and then they just go to camp kindergarten. There's not enough kids in that building to have a separate classroom teacher structure of their afternoon activities. You understand?
They're not going to a second kindergarten. They're going to, so my son isn't going to a separate kindergarten in the second half of the day. He goes and a special education teacher is accommodating his needs and working with him, and we have a K-2 room and a 3-5 room.
But all the kids in that general population are pulled from the whole district to go to the building.
No, they're not. This is one, every building, he's in his home school. They don't have a specific kindergarten full day option like that. This is him going to special ed like any other kid who needs special ed in first grade, second grade, third, you know, whatever, that gets pulled in. And so those kids are going to that room together. And now you've got these kids that right now there's less of them, and so they don't have as much interaction with their peers because there's fewer of them.
Yeah.
And when you're putting more of them together, now they have a more inclusive setting to practice some of those social and emotional learning skills with each other because they have more kids in there. Right now you have a situation where a lot of times they want to try to build those skills in that environment and they can't because you have one other kid or 2 other kids to try to build those skills with. And if you have all these kids that are trying to build the same school skills elsewhere, why not do that and combine, add those kids to what we're already doing in those individual buildings?
So these, the population that we're talking about though for this program aren't necessarily kids that might already be receiving services or be identified or have
these,
even not the students coming in.
So this is like anybody coming in, sign their child up for registration. Are we going to test every single kindergartner then that comes in March and April, you know, and test them to see where they fall? And then we've got a pile of kids that don't qualify and a pile of kids that do. And that maybe these are kids that, you know, said don't receive, didn't have any preschool.
But that is what we're doing. They're testing
every
one of those kids in this proposal. Either way, you're doing the same thing. You're testing all of those kids.
But I'm saying that that a lot of the kids that are right now being pushed in for inclusion, like your situation, or the students that are at my son's school, they were identified prior to kindergarten registration. They came in with some paperwork and some needs. So this is more, if I was just to come in and I didn't have any paperwork and I hadn't had any assessment with my child and I'm just coming in to register for kindergarten next year, and you're testing everybody that's coming in, and you're going to say, Mrs. Walters, we have some concerns based off of how your child did on the test. We recommend this if I was a grantor, seller.
Correct.
And then you can expand based off of how we do the next year, expand this program moving forward and try to hit more buildings and expand this program across the nation.
Right, you're testing all those kids ahead of time in either one of these scenarios.
Well, that's just the numbers of the SP
change. The numbers have changed from each school from year to year. So it
could
be 3, 7. I think that's why you're talking about combining them into one school. So you know,
take them to one. I think that you're talking about two different, things where it wouldn't necessarily be beneficial to combine them all, because the children that are coming, I can't explain, but it might not mesh, but I mean, I don't know. And then as far as I do like keeping kids in their own, you know, in their own school, but there are a lot of students who right now don't go to kindergarten in Penridge anyway, because we don't offer a full day. So when you come into first grade, there's a lot of mixing up. So from kindergarten to first grade, maybe not as big of a deal to not be necessarily in your school, but can you talk about how it would be different from, it seems like these kids, as Lisa's saying, they don't already have, the parents aren't aware.
Right, so these are students who would not be coming in with any early intervention services or anything of other services prior to kindergarten. So the other thing, and I hear what you're saying about that inclusion model, the other piece that I would just get concerned about, and I'd have to think this out more, is just that if you did, it would reduce the number of students that you screen to be able to complete that class. Because if there's, let's just say there's 5 other kids to be inclusion into in the afternoon part of that, then you're now at 15, so you're only going to bring 10 in. So I'm looking at numbers in regards to how many kids you can service as well, because they're already receiving that full day. So
but
now
you're talking
I mean,
about doing those numbers anyway when you spread that out across 7 different buildings. That's what you're looking at.
But there are
limits to the number of people that can be. So if you have a group of special ed students, for example, is there a limit, you know, to the number of students that the teacher would be able to effectively work with? You know, if you have, it's not the same as just say in my mind like in inclusion where you have a few students who need extra help going into a group of, you know, a large group of students that don't need help. You'd be having now all the students in this classroom need concentrated help, and so would it be more difficult? Would you still be able to have the success that you wanted to have? Would you need another teacher?
Well, that's why they have the 8 and the 15 students.
Yeah,
that's why you're getting the class size. It's 10.
But would it still be the same situation if you added them to what's already existing?